Somebody mentioned to me, so glad you got here just the same. But anyway, I'm glad that you are here. I want to draw your attention to something. It's not quite in the bulletin yet, but I want you to go ahead and look ahead at your calendar this week and make sure you mark down Sunday, January the 24th. We will have a guest preacher that morning. Greg Addison from the Arkansas Baptist State Convention will be with us to talk to us a little bit, preach about prayer and teach us a little bit as a church about how to organize a prayer ministry, to organize that so that we as a church can do this. The two things that a church, the things that we can control are what we do. We can't control the things that go on around us and outside of us, but what we can control is how much we pray, how much we look to the Word of God, and how much we share the gospel with the people around us, and how much we love one another. Those things are in our control. And so that's why I've challenged you. We're going to do things like church Bible memory verses. We've got to read through the Bible plan. If you've got one you prefer to that one, go ahead. You may not want to try to read Genesis, Ezra, Matthew, and Acts, you know, and read across four places. You may want to read differently. That's fine. You may want to do, you know, follow a little bit different, but I want to challenge you to be in the Word every day. I want to challenge us as a church to be in prayer very diligently. I want us to look for ways that we can grow in our love and our commitment to one another and draw nearer to each other and to the Lord in that way, and then to reach out to our community around us. And then from that, we'll trust God to do the things that we can't do or take part in. But do want to do this as our ushers are coming forward to collect our morning offering. So come on, ushers. As they come forward to us and collect our morning offering, keep in mind this is part of our worship. This is not simply collecting to pay the rent on the building. Folks, thanks to God's faithfulness and church members' obedience, the building's not rented, it's paid for. This is a part of our worship. This is part of us giving from what God has blessed us with. This is a part of what we do to say to God, we trust Him to take care of what we need. I do want to take note of your generosity in the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions. I appreciate all of you who gave to that. You'll see that final number there in the bulletin. If you forgot, you're going, oh no, the only thing that happens if you bring your Lottie Moon offering this week, next week, or on down the line is that the IRS requires that you take it on this year's taxes and not last year's. I assure you, the International Mission Board can use it. I've never met a missionary who felt that they were completely, fully funded any more than I've known missionaries that were completely, fully prayed for. So one way or the other, they would appreciate that. But this is how God meets the needs of this church to do what we do here. And part of this does go on to help spread the gospel around the world and also around East End from right outside our door all the way around. So, Don, yes.
Father, we come to you this morning and we're thankful for the privilege of coming to your house, Father, and to study your word and to praise you, precious. Dear Father, I ask a blessing for each one here. I ask that you want to hear, but not really. This is deep time for the Holy Spirit. So it's so hard to realize their lost condition. So I ask a blessing on this offering that will be used in the way of this person here. I ask that you forgive us and say, sins will be favored. Director of
Pathway. Thank you.
come to our prayer time this morning, it comes to looking at what to focus on. There are so many things upon us, but I want to draw what I bring to your attention simply from what our Bible reading plan is. You may have looked at it and thought, why in the world does that Bible reading plan start? It starts at Genesis 1, Ezra 1, Matthew 1, and Acts chapter 1. Well, this was written up by a pastor in Scotland a long time ago. Really long ago to some of our younger folks, because it's the 1800s, okay? So it's a long time ago. But what he did is he picked the four beginnings in Scripture. Genesis 1, the beginning of everything, right? Our memory verse, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis 1:1. Ezra chapter 1 is the beginning of the restored kingdom of Israel after they've come out of the exile. Matthew 1 is the beginning of the gospel of the story of Jesus Christ. And Acts chapter 1 is the beginning of the church. So it's the four beginnings, and you start there. And so as we take a few moments to pause in prayer this morning, I want to challenge you to lift up in prayer the beginnings. It's the third day of the new year. I've already violated 6 out of 12 New Year's resolutions. As with my friend who posts his church curmudgeon on Facebook, I have resolved to not eat any more donuts this year, nor to eat any less donuts. Now, some of you got that. It's a time for us to think about new beginnings. For ourselves, for our church, for our nation. We elect a new president this year. There are so many new things upon us. And if you say, no, my life is pretty stable, first of all, I would warn you about that. Part of what I wanted you to capture from that missions video this morning is that was a couple that was very happy in their church. Everything was nice and stable, and they were all very pleased. And God had other plans for them. But the other is that there are people around you who are facing newness. Some of you are joyfully no longer going to work tomorrow morning. See the big smile on Kathy Purvis's face because she got to retire. Some of you are not so joyfully not going to work tomorrow morning because you didn't plan on that. Some of you are joyfully looking ahead at the year, and some of you dread, or you know people that dread the consequences. I have a dear friend, and she will, but by about halfway through the year, she'll be a grandma. She is a little young for that because she's my age. I'm not comfortable with that. But, there are things that happen. There's newness that comes. So be in prayer for the people around you about that. So let's just take a few moments, and we'll go in prayer to the Lord quietly, and then in a moment or two, I'll lead us as we do the Lord's Prayer, which will be there on the screen for those of us that need it. So let's pray. Join me as we pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. If you take your Bibles and turn with me to John chapter 5, we'll be back to the Gospel of John for the month of January, because I like the Gospel of John, and someday we're going to finish going through it. I find, you know, I was thinking through the number of my favorite authors whose names, you know, include John. Most of my favorite my two favorite Old Testament authors, John. I honestly don't know, you know, J. Scott Duvall, is his first name John too? Favorite New Testament authors, I think, is either John or Jonathan. Favorite early church writer's name is John. It's just I guess it's because my name is actually John. Some of you don't realize that. But that's actually my first name is John. I go by my middle name just to keep everybody guessing. But we've got to come back to John and finish him up. We'll go John, and then we'll kind of do some other things, and we'll spend, you know, a while on it. I don't want to get y'all completely just bored to death, and I don't want you to think that there's only one book in the Bible. We want to get the whole of Scripture and get it all together. But we're going to be in John chapter 5 this morning, and we're going to do verses 1 through 17. So if you would stand with me in honor of reading God's Word. John 5, beginning with verse 1. Now after these things, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the Sheep Gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porticos. In these lay a multitude of those who were sick, blind, lame, and withered, waiting for the moving of the waters. For an angel of the Lord went down at certain seasons into the pool and stirred up the water. Whoever then first, after the stirring up of the water, stepped in was made well from whatever disease with which he was afflicted. A man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been a long time, he said to him, "Do you wish to get well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your pallet, and walk." Immediately the man became well and picked up his pallet and began to walk. Now it was the Sabbath on that day, so the Jews were saying to the man who was cured, "It is the Sabbath. It's not permissible for you to carry your pallet." He answered them, "He who made me well was the one who said to me, 'Pick up your pallet and walk.'" They asked him, "Who is the man who said to you, 'Pick up your pallet and walk?'" But the man who was healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had slipped away while there was a crowd in that place. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "Behold, you've become well. Do not sin anymore, so that nothing worse happens to you." The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. For this reason, the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. But he answered them, "My Father is working until now, and I myself am working." Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. We pray that you will speak to us by it this morning. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Now, there's a lot to find here, and a lot that we need to be aware of. First of all is, of course, that we see God at work healing. Now, I can't fully explain the whole thing with the angel stirring up the waters and all of that there at Bethesda or Bethsaida. There's a lot of argument about what the right way is to spell that and then pronounce it into English. Doesn't really matter that much. It's Bethesda or Bethsaida or possibly a couple of other things. What we do know is that somehow, at various times, God enabled those who were there to be healed. But it was kind of an iffy thing about how you could get there and what would happen and all of that. And we also know this, at this point, it doesn't happen there anymore because that old pool is gone. This is a pool. It was a very real place. Don't, you know, catch the idea of what John gives you there. This is where it was. It was there by the sheep gate where the sheep came and went. This man is there, and he's been there for a while, meaning healing. And needing, knowing that he needs the power of God to heal him. But he's also there very much alone. It's a lot like most of the people that we know, and in fact, a lot like quite a few of us. We know we need something. And we think we know where to get it. But we need help. And so often this world passes by those people who need help the most around them. Either because the world is more concerned with its own needs. You've got to figure that here's a man who's been ill 38 years. And you could probably take it from that he's been there by the pool for most of that time. Other people have come and gone with their illnesses. His has lingered. People have come, and whatever they've got, whatever's wrong with them, it's not so bad that they can't beat him to the water. Whatever's wrong with them, they can beat him to the water, so you know they could probably stand away a little bit longer. The world around us is a lot like the people there at the pool. It's more concerned with its own needs than with those in greater distress. And so often we're that way within the church. We're more concerned with our own needs than we are with the people around us. I wanted this and I wanted that, and yet all around us people are dying, going to hell. All around us people within the church are dying a little bit inside, and that fracture in our relationships and the body of Christ keeps us from drawing near to one another to do the work that God's given us to do. Because our eyes stay fixed on us instead of on where our eyes should be. And into this situation, Jesus comes. It says he goes up to Jerusalem for the feast of the Jews. This is probably the Passover. It doesn't say that explicitly, but it probably is. Keep in mind, if you go back to your Old Testament, you will find that there are three times a year that the men of Israel were commanded to all come together to worship the Lord. Passover was one of them, to celebrate God's deliverance of the people from slavery in Egypt. And we never see Jesus skip a Passover. That's important when you come down here in a minute and the Jews are fussing at him for what he's doing on the Sabbath. Because it's important for us to see, and we talked a little bit about this Wednesday night with the Wednesday night crowd, with Luke showing Jesus never violates the clear dictates of Scripture. They're about to fuss at him because on the Sabbath, he's healing people, and they don't like that. They get on to him about that quite a few times. Because they had taken the commandment, remember thou the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor, and on the seventh you shall not labor, you shall rest, because the Lord rested on the seventh day and kept, you know, and blessed it and made it holy. And they had taken that as a commandment of God and built up law all the way around it. You say, what does that mean to build up law all the way around it? Well, if you can imagine taking something that's important, that's very special, we'll take my wedding ring. I like this ring. It's one of the few things that I own that I have had for longer than 10 years. I've never lost it. I have never misplaced it. In fact, it's on most of the time, except for those rare cases that I hold it up and I keep expecting myself to drop this in the floor while I stand here and tell you how important it is. This ring stays right there, and it has a meaning, it has a purpose. But I can say, well, this is special, and so what I'm going to do is I'm going to put it in a vault. I'm going to put it in a safe that we'll put in a vault that then we'll make sure that we lock down inside all of the security around it. We were at the state capitol a couple of weeks ago. We were actually in the vault of the state of Arkansas, which was pretty cool. You may have seen, if you follow Ann or I on Facebook, if we're connected on that, you may have seen a picture of the kids holding this huge amount of money. That was your money, Arkansas taxpayers, by the way. They didn't take any of it. But they were in the middle of the vault inside the state capitol. And if you go during work hours, you can actually go in and say, hey, can you tour the vault and hold the money? It's the law. Okay? But it's also kind of cool to stand there and hold $325,000. And to wonder whether or not I was faster than the guy who let us in. But I know I'm not. I may have been faster than him, but I wasn't faster than the radio on the security, on the Capitol police officer out front. Take it all and lock it up in there. And you lose the access to it, and you can protect it. You can make sure. I could have left my wedding ring in there, down in the bottom part where they used to keep the gold bullion that belonged to the state of Arkansas. Could lock it up in there. And you'd never see the ring, but I could assure you that it was secure. Well, that's what legalism does. That's what the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the years of tradition, centuries of tradition, had done with the law about remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. They had taken what God had said, keep it holy, and they had said, well, we want to make sure we don't do this, because that might risk us not keeping it holy. Oh, wait, we want to make sure, and spreads on out from there. Such that they had reached a point that it was illegal in Israel at the time to miraculously heal people on the Sabbath. Let that soak in for a second. They had determined that it was illegal for doctors, physicians to work. They didn't want anybody going to healers on the Sabbath. And they had added into there, under any circumstances, nobody's supposed to be healed on the Sabbath. Let that one sink in. This is part of the law that they had constructed. See, they had taken what God had said and added to it to make sure nobody accidentally tripped over it. And we need to be careful about that type of thing. Jesus respects the law that God has given. What he does not respect and does not follow is all of the customs that have been added to it. So he obeys what God had commanded. He's not as interested in what people had commanded. That's worth remembering. But he does go up to gather at the Passover. God had commanded that his people gather to worship and remember what God had done. There are times that we need to gather and remember what God has done. And if Jesus went to those kinds of things, you think it's probably valuable for us too as well? Worth being there. So meanwhile, he goes, he sees this man, he says, do you want to be well? The man says, yeah, I'd kind of like to. I just need some help. See, unlike the man that's healed when his four friends cut a hole in the roof and lowered down to it, this guy's all alone. Jesus says, well, fine, pick up your mat and go home. Clean up your stuff and get out of here. And so as he does this, Jesus disappears off into the crowd. Now, the Passover in Israel, in Jerusalem at the time, you just thought it was crowded at the mall Christmas Eve when you were out Christmas shopping for your wives, man. That's got nothing on the Passover. Y'all thought it was crowded catching the after Christmas sales the day after. That's nothing compared to the Passover. Okay? Picture stacking up the World Series, the Super Bowl, and the World Champion Barbecue Competition. Put all of it during Memphis in May, and put it all right downtown. And you still don't have the crowd that is. So it's easy for Jesus to kind of fade into that crowd at the time. And so he fades away into the crowd. The man's carrying his mat through. And real quick, the religious leaders notice him. It's not lawful for you to carry your mat around on the Sabbath. He says, but the guy who healed me said to take up my mat and go home. We have a question ahead of us in the years to come as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, church. We have the one who has healed us and delivered us from sin and death. And we have people around us who want to make rules for us that say, don't be obnoxious about your religion and tell people that much about Jesus. Don't be so mean as to think that he's the only way. Don't be so grumpy as to expect people to listen when you talk about the gospel. We have the one who has delivered us from sin and death, and we have people who would rather we just simply put everything down and blend in quietly with the crowd. And we're going to have to decide which side of that we want to obey. Who do we want to follow? Do we want to listen to a world which has its own agenda, or do we want to listen to the one without whom we wouldn't simply be laying crippled by a pool, we would be dead in our sins and our trespasses? Now we've got a choice. think you know which choice we ought to make. But for far too long, we as God's people have sat down and made the other choice. For far too long, we've said, well, okay. For far too long, we've said, well, yes, we want to do this. But we want to honor God, but we really don't want to cause a stir. We want to honor God, but we don't want to. We also want to make sure that we have this and we have that. We don't want to be the one that shows up at the class reunion and come to find out isn't, you know, rich and famous like everybody else was. Heaven forbid we surrendered all of that for the gospel of Jesus Christ to be good church members and good Sunday school teachers. Heaven forbid we did this or we did that to walk with Jesus instead of chase after the things of this world. We want to do that. We'll follow God as much as we can in the middle of that. But we sure don't want to stand out and tell the world no. We don't want to have that kind of problem. That causes us nothing but trouble. Well, that's what's happening to this man. He gets nothing but trouble out of this. He says, you know, I don't even know for sure who it was that told me to pick up my pallet and walk. I know this, though. He healed me. He told me to pick up my pallet and walk. You come a couple of chapters farther down in the Gospel of John, you encounter the man who's born blind, and he has the same problem. I don't know who gave me my sight, but I'm glad he did. Then later they find out it was Jesus. Well, we already know who it is. We don't even have to go back and look. We don't have to wait for the Lord to find us again. We can say, look, Jesus did this. So let's let the world know that. Not let the world know what our political opinions are and what our football opinions are. Not that there's anything wrong with most of our football opinions. Some of you there are. Not that there's anything wrong with prayerfully seeking and supporting those who will help guide our nation and bring justice. But greater than that should be our compassionate drive to share the gospel with people around us. It shouldn't be that we are so obsessed with making sure we elect the right person president that we condemn our neighbors to hell because we don't tell them about Jesus, but we sure do tell them about fill in the blank. I can't even list all the candidates. We still need about 400 Republicans to drop out of the race for president. I don't know. I honestly do not know how many are in there. I could name about six of them. We can get obsessed about making sure our neighbors know to vote for Rubio or Cruz or Trump or Clinton or Fiorina or Huckabee still in? Anybody know? Or did he quit? Huckabee. He is a better preacher than he is a politician. And so on and so forth. Before we worry about that, let's worry about Jesus as King before we worry about who our president's going to be. Let's let that be what drives us every day as we go through this. Jesus finds the man and says, you should probably stop carrying your mat through town. He says, don't keep sinning because otherwise something worse will happen to you. Now, I happen to agree with the Bible scholars who look at this and see that Jesus is not warning him that God is going to do something to him. And he's not telling him that his illness and his lameness was the result of sin. He's actually warning him, you should probably go put the mat down before the religious leaders decide to take out their anger with me on you. Because we see this later with the story of Lazarus. If you've never noticed it, there's a little verse that talks about that after Jesus has raised Lazarus from the dead, and Lazarus is going around, the story's getting where they start plotting not only to kill Jesus, but they want to kill Lazarus too. And that way Lazarus goes back to being dead like they wanted him to. Folks, when you are so obsessed with your religious viewpoint that you would rather people go back to being lame or dead just so that you can be right about whether or not they should have done one little thing, carried a mat on a Saturday. Always keep in mind that the Sabbath is Saturday. Most of y'all do lots of work on the Sabbath. You'd rather somebody go back to crippled than able to walk and praise God because they didn't follow your rule. We're starting to line up with the Pharisees more than we ought to. So the man goes away, told the Jews it was Jesus who had made him well. The Jews were out to get Jesus. And then we get to this final verse. It's the one you see up there. He answers them, "My Father is working until now, and I myself am working." A couple of truths about this. Number one, we see here Jesus identifying himself as God. Why? This one's a little bit out of order from the Greek. It's better in order than like NIV and such are. But it is, "I am myself working." Told y'all this last May, there's places in John where Jesus uses that phrasing. He says of himself, "I am," and then he tells something else about it. And he says it in such a way that you don't, he didn't have to put it that way. He could have just said, "I am working," or "myself I'm working," working, that those types of things. But he's drawing this out, the I am part. Go back to Exodus 3 and you see God gives that as his name.